Remember not the sins of my youth, nor the transgressions, but according to your mercy, think on me.
We brought nothing into the world, and we take nothing out. The Lord gives, and the Lord takes away. Blessed be the name of the Lord.
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, in your Son, Jesus Christ, you have given us a true faith and a sure hope. Help us to live as those who believe in the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, and the resurrection to eternal life. And strengthen this faith and hope in us all the days of our life. Through the love of your Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen.
Good morning, family and friends of our dear sister Betsy Fanike. I greet you in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. Welcome to the house of the Lord. Could I please ask you to keep your cell phone switch off or on silent for the duration of the service. We are here this morning to give thanks and to celebrate the life of Betsy. This sunny, cheerful, joyful, always smiling, bubbly, God-fearing, and loving friend of ours. If it was under different circumstances, we would have sung our hearts out for Betsy today. Let us pray. Our God, our Heavenly Father, we are gathered here today, Lord, not only to grieve the loss of Sister Betsy, but also to give thanks to you, Lord, for her life among us. We give thanks for the gift of life, the gift of family, and the gift of friendships. Our God, our Father, may we all be strengthened by your word, knowing and believing that you will be with us forever. You promise in your word that you will never leave us or forsake us. You are with us today and to the ends of our days. We know and trust, Lord, that you were at Betsy's side till the end of her days. May she spend eternity with you. I pray that she will live in your presence forever. In Psalm 34, verse 18, it is written, "The Lord is close to those whose hearts are breaking. May the Lord comfort the family during this time of loss. Lord, pour your blessings over this family and walk ahead of them, especially the children, Louis, Terence, Anita, Gareth, Denise, Lucille, and all the grandchildren, her sisters and brother, and many nephews and nieces. Enfold them in your loving arms, O Lord. This we ask in the wonderful name of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. Amen." Could we remain standing for Louis to play us "Immortal, Invisible, God Only One"? And after that, I will ask Irene to do the eulogy.
Thank you. this morning not to mourn the passing away of a beloved mother, grandmother, aunt, sister, friend, or colleague, but to truly celebrate and give thanks for the long life God granted Betsy. At this juncture, I would particularly like to express my heartfelt and sincere gratitude to Betsy for bestowing the honor and privilege upon me to pay the last and final tribute to you, my Mikey. Allow me to share with you what gives me comfort and about death, and especially Betsy's death. I see death as follows. Death is not God's punishment or cruelty, but it is actually his most thrilling, sacred embrace of his own child. Betsy, my all-time beloved friend, this eulogy is for you with love. All honor, glory, praise, and thanksgiving to God, our Creator and Savior, for allotting you with 80 years, 6 months, and 18 days of life filled with his glorious mercy and grace. What can I say to this but just concur with the psalmist as he records in Psalm 90, verse 10, 70 years is all we have, 80 years if we are strong, yet all they bring us is trouble and sorrow. Life is soon over and we are gone. For you, my dearest friend, it was meant to be 80 years, even though we wished it could have been longer. Friends, paying tribute to an octogenarian can be the most challenging and daunting task, especially if she is your closest and best friend. But I am fortunate enough that this is not the case, for Betsy's past life makes this the easiest task I have ever undertaken. Friends, I'm sure many of you have been part of Auntie B's life and will cherish the times you shared with her. Yes, each one with his or her own beliefs of who she really was. Let me give you an inkling of how I knew her, and perhaps, just maybe, our perceptions may be divergent. But please do not disapprove of your perception, because that is who she really was for you. Now, how can I describe Betsy's life? Having walked this life closely with Betsy for the past 45 years, I could find better or apt description than referring to some scripture verses that gave me a deeper understanding of the life she lived. It is just as St. Paul writes in 1 Corinthians 15, chapter 15, verse 58, "Therefore, my dear brothers and sisters, stand firm, let nothing move you. Always give yourself fully to the work of the Lord, because you know that your labor in the Lord is not in vain." That was Betsy. Further, St. Paul writes in Galatians chapter 6, verse 9, "Let us not become weary in doing good, for at the proper time we will reap a harvest if we do not give up." That's Betsy. She never gave up. And also in the book of James chapter 1, verse 12, which reads, "Blessed is the one who persevere under trial, because having stood the test, that person will receive the crown of life that the Lord has promised those who love him." I firmly believe, and I believe that the Haven Ladies, the angels as we call one another, that gathered every week on a Tuesday in Betsy's home to have our Bible study, to support one another, to encourage one another, on our spiritual path of growing and development will concur with me on this one and many parishioners of this church, as St. Paul and James writes about Christians. Let us look at the character of Auntie B. That is, who is Betsy? She is that young camphor girl who hails from Dexelfontein, which is on the outskirts of Alexandria. She came from poor and humble beginnings and forged her life against all odds to reach a God-ordained destiny. My friends, there are numerous adjectives that can describe her character. I trust that I will do justice on this one. Betsy is a woman of free spirit, deeply religious and spiritual, a woman of prayer. She is caring, sharing, loving, forgiving, trustworthy, dependable, humble, courageous, and tenacious as Lynette, who is an angel, shared with all the other angels during the course of this week that Betsy is a woman of irrepressible character. And can I add from my side, authentic in the true sense of the word. B, as I called her, was a woman who was very particular about her appearance, always neatly dressed and appropriately dressed for the occasion. Not a single hair out of place. And wow, a favorite hallmark, the lipstick. You will never find her without her lipstick. Even if it's in the wee hours of the morning when she would wake up at about 6:30 and decide that the garden needs to be watered, the lipstick was there. Weaving, anything she was doing, the lipstick was her hallmark. For me personally, she was a mother and I a daughter to her. A sister, a confidant, a mutual soul partner, my own Barnabas, encourager, motivator, and inspiration. Yes, she was my devoted and true friend for life. And that I believe to be true to especially the Haven ladies, the majority of parishioners, this church, young and old, even the past and incumbent priests of St. Mark and St. John. Wow, what a glorious gift from God. Betsy and I had an interconnection and synergy that withstood the test of time. We had our own special code and sign language, which her late husband and the children could not fathom or uncode. They could not trust us, or they could not trust us out of their sight. They maintained that they would not have a clue of what's coming next if they lost sight of us. We had secret code names and signs for many people. It even included priests and bishops who were in our target range. Who would know when we said, for example, patroon, or venti, vanger, mont, regalia, crown jewels, thousands, groote, bombeltje, and elder. That had the two of us bursting out in laughter, for if that particular person was in that company, they were none the wiser whom we were referring to. We left it for the other parties to do the uncoding. My dear friends, Betsy had no shred of racism in her. Her attitude towards all people was the same, irrespective of their class, race, color, status, or creed. Every everyone was treated with due respect, love, and understanding, just as the commandment instructs, love others as you love yourself. She always saw the positive and never the negative in people, thus boosting their morale and self-worth. Yagetsi knew what it was to sacrifice, giving of herself wholly and completely. She would give her very last to anyone in need, not knowing how she would manage later on. This, for me, was complete trust and belief in God, seeing the trust and believing God emotionally. Betsy's home had a warm and welcoming atmosphere, and everybody always welcome, whether friend, family, passerby through the town, one looking for a safe shelter, you name it, they were all welcome. It was a peaceful, loving place where fun, joy, happiness, and peace and belonging could be experienced at its fullest. Furthermore, no one would leave her home without having something to eat or drink, and this commendable attribute has been passed on to her children. Another incident that forced me to dub her the Mother Teresa of Galvin Park was when a youngster came in the front door, filthy, clothes his body, and he was asking for a piece of bread. This poor child, I think, didn't see water, a drop of water in his clothes for many days. Guess what? Betsy took him into the backyard, gave him a good scrubbing, a warm wash, gave him a set of fresh, clean clothing and the bread that he asked for. And then the youngster was sent off with a washing rag, a bar of soap, and with a strict instruction to be clean when he comes around the next time. That, for me, was the thing about Mother Teresa. She knew it. How she dealt with people knocking at her front door with their various needs, reminded me of her obeying the scripture in Matthew 25, verses 35 and 36. I was hungry, and you fed me, naked, and you clothed me, thirsty, and you gave me a drink. I was a stranger, and you received me in your home. Commendable achievement for the kingdom of God. Friends, I would also be failing in my duty if I do not applaud and thank and recognize her for the sterling job she did in raising three boys and daughter after their father's passing. Thank you also, Bea, for including me in their upbringing and nurturing and allowing me to also be their mother. I truly appreciated that. It meant a lot to me, even to this day. I must acknowledge it was not an easy task for her, bringing up her children. Can I ask the guys, do you remember Mom standing in the passage every Sunday morning without fail, saying, boys, boys, you must get up for church, and the Irene must also use the bathroom. That after a late night of watching movies on TV, church was a non-negotiable with her. Speaking of Sunday, guys, there is one thing your mother dreaded the most on a Sunday afternoon. That was those late telephone calls. She knew that either of you would give her a call, and we were sitting in the lounge, and the telephone would ring. I reluctantly did not answer it because I knew she knew that it was for her. She would talk to whoever was on the phone, and after a while I would just see the hand motioning to me to come near while speaking to one of you. I didn't know what it was, but as I came nearer, she said, hold on, Auntie Irene. Poor me. I knew that this was a case of encouraging, motivating, and giving you confidence that it will be okay, whatever the problem may be. Lastly, and last but not least, Auntie B, Betsy, has left large footprints in this church because she simply adored laboring in God's vineyard. We know that we all have, there is always that something that is a first in your life. Now, these are the following firsts for Betsy. It's a remarkable and noteworthy achievements in this church. She was the first female lay minister to be licensed in this church. The first female to teach confirmation classes that was previously taken by priests. This she simply adored, especially working with the youth. She was also the first coordinator for the first Alpha course at St. Mark and St. John's. Father Ben can bear me out on that one. She continued to hold that position for the subsequent four courses on which she urged me to join her as coordinators of the Alpha courses. Always, and with the exception of one provincial diocesan synod, she was unanimously nominated as a delegate from St. Mark and St. John. Another first was being part of the mission team with the late Bishop Eric Pike and Joyce, his wife, in the Humansdorp Archdeaconry. I don't know if there's anybody from this church that has ever been on a team that led a mission. Lastly, Betsy and I served as representatives of our church on Exodus Initiative, a Christian-based community organization for PE that was an organization that was interdenominational. Noteworthy also was that Betsy was a dedicated and staunch member of our church choir. With their melodic, sweet, gentle, and angelic voices, they not only lifted and enhanced our praise and Eucharistic services, but brought honor to God under the leadership of Margie Thomas. And you know, even when we were on our overseas trip, Sunday was non-negotiable. We had to go to a service. And in Switzerland, I don't think they can really sing. And we in church, and we knew the hymn, we would belt it out, and the congregation would turn around and who's singing? And when we, after the service, they would ask, are you coming again next week? Yeah. So, and I think, I'm sure, Auntie Margie and all choir members who are here, that her voice will be truly missed in the choir. This in no way captures the whole of Betsy and her life. More can be added to the portrait. Now to conclude, if there was a message that she will leave with us, I simply believe it would be this. We are all going to die. That is our destination. We are fellow sailors on the same way to the same port. How long the voyage would last is different for all. It is for each of us to decide how we shall make the journey and what we shall gain from it. Some travelers will learn everything that happens along the way, change because of what they have learned, and arrive quite different from what they were when they started. Others will complain throughout the voyage, criticize their fellow travelers, and arrive at the final destination still angry, jealous, vengeful, and frightened. The voyage is an opportunity. How you use the opportunity is up to you. That is the choice that you must take at each moment. What you choose at each moment, moves you along on a journey on earth. Will you arrive grateful and wise, caring for your fellow travelers and receiving the care that they have for you, or will you arrive complaining about them and the trip? Betsy, our beloved, Betsy, we, your beloved children, family and friends, salute you. Your voice forever still, but it shall echo through the corridors of our hearts until traveling days are done. May God's perpetual light shine upon you and give you peace. Rus soet en sag in hemelse vrede, my lewenslange vriend en maatjie. Rest in glorious peace till we meet again in the new Jerusalem.
Graceful, generous heart, it beats no more. and local teachings are lost and always will remain gone in the breath that spoke these words and made them echo true. That was from Terence. I'm going to do a tribute, a small, short tribute to Auntie Betsy. Irene has mentioned quite a few things, and we didn't put payments. As I sat at my desk, I was wondering what was I going to say about Auntie Betsy? My Aegana Auntie, but my uncle's. Someone whom I had a close relationship for over 56 years. I was reminded of the lyrics of the beautiful hymn written by Ruth K. Jones, which goes something like this. In times like these, you need a savior. In times like these, you need an anchor. Be sure, be very sure. Your anchor holds and grips the soul of God. This rock is Jesus. Yes? He is the one. This rock is Jesus, the only one. When I go down, brother Betsy to an Adela holiday to introduce her to his sister, my mother, I said to myself, yes, my uncle has got possessed. In other words, he had stuck. I only realized later that Uncle Don saw in his prospective lifelong partner a wife with a heart of gold, hidden behind that pure white tennis dress. The marital union of Uncle Don and Betsy lasted just over 15 and a half years. When Uncle Don passed away, Auntie Betsy was left to care for Louis, who was only 14 years old, Gareth was 12, Terence was 11, and Lucille 7. This she did with distinction. Things were tough, nevertheless, Auntie Betsy's rock was Jesus. She cared, disciplined, and nurtured them single-handedly until all four of them graduated. She lived the miracle of the five loaves of bread. Betsy, and used to drive down to Port Elizabeth to visit her as often as possible. Whenever possible during our visits, we used to set time aside for what we call tea time. That was 3 o'clock in the afternoon, whenever we could, sit around the kitchen table and enjoy a cup of tea. With simple things like lemon creams and ginger biscuits. Tea was made in a teapot, poured in a proper teacup, and matching saucer. Now there was also a teaspoon there. We would either tell each other jokes, or talk about family matters, or discuss topics, general topics. This was our bonding time. I'm going to miss. in the fact that Auntie Betsy is in safe hands. And he's looking down on you. Cherish all the memories that you have of her. She's probably singing the chorus of that beautiful hymn written by John W. Peterson, which goes something like this. I have a home beyond the river. I have a mansion, right, and free. I have a home beyond the river. I will dwell in Jesus' name. Allow me to share the following words with you that I recently read. The author is Anna, and it goes like this. There are things that we do not want to happen, but have to accept. Things we don't want to know, but have to learn. And people who can't live without, and people we cannot live without, but we have to let go. Louis Derrance, Gareth and Russell, thank you very much for looking after TB while she was still alive. And particularly Russell, thank you very much for caring for Betsy when she needed it the most. Finally, TB, sleep on, my mother, sleep on, and take the rest. Be down my head upon my Savior's breast. We love thee well, but Jesus loves thee best. Good night. Good night. Good night.
That there's not a dry eye in the church today. Mom always told us that she did not want us to cry at a funeral, but clearly that was always going to be impossible. Mom said that she wanted us to celebrate her life, and I think it is appropriate that we celebrate the conclusion of Mom's journey here at St. Mark and St. John's, because the church was always so central in her life. I can proudly say that Mum never failed in her duty to give us a good Christian upbringing. And she always did it by example. And she always did it in prayer, in every circumstance. And she always reminded us to pray too. And she always remained steadfast in her faith. And above all, she knew Jesus Christ as her Lord and Savior. Mum, you are the kindest, the most wonderful and the most beautiful mother I could have ever asked for. And you are also the most loved. I am going to miss you so much. You rest in peace now. Thank you.
Good day, beloveds. Greetings in Jesus' name. I'm going to read Psalms 23. The Psalm of David. The Lord is my shepherd, I shall not want. He makes me lie down in green pastures. He leads me beside quiet waters. He restores my soul. He guides me in the paths of righteousness. For his name's sake, even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil. For you are with me, your rod and your staff, they comfort me. You prepare a table before me in the presence of my enemies. You anoint my head with oil, my cup overflows. Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life, and I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever. Amen.
Good morning, everybody. This is verse 14, 1 to 6 from the book of John. Do not let your hearts be troubled. Trust in God. Trust also in me. In my Father's house are many rooms. If it were not so, I would have told you. I am going there to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come back and take you to be with me, that you also may be where I am. You know the way to the place where I am going. Thomas said to him, Lord, we don't know where you are going, so how can we know the way? Jesus answered, I am the way and the truth and the life. No one comes to the Father except through me. If you really knew me, you would know my Father as well. From now on, you do know him and have seen him.
Good
Let us pray. Heavenly Father, your word is a light unto our path, the wisdom of the mind, and the love in our hearts. As we proclaim your word of encouragement at this appointed time, as we lay to rest the mortal remains of your servant Betsy, we pray that our hearts may receive from your bounty of grace, that we may believe and live by it. This we ask and pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Please be seated. Beloved in Christ, we are here today to lay to rest the mortal remains of our beloved Auntie Betsy van Niekerk. We've heard the eulogy, the tributes, and much commentary regarding her life, witness, and testimony, and the legacy she leaves behind for us. So I ask the question, how should we refer to Betsy van Niekerk? Do we reference her as a mother, a friend, a companion, a believer, a follower of Christ, a disciple of Jesus, a herald of the gospel, prayer warrior, or daughter of the soil? If you were to ask me, I would have no hesitation to say all of the above. Because Betsy's life was the manifestation of these terms, she lived them out. Her greatest achievement is not the raising of her children as a single mom, persevering and overcoming the challenges that comes with that. But I believe the greatest achievement of Betsy van Niekerk is that she called Jesus a Lord and Savior, and she dwelled with him every day of her life. Jesus shows us from time to time again that he is capable and would provide for those who follow him, just as the good shepherd provides for the sheep. And so Jesus provides for his followers. And no better description of this exists other than the Psalm 23. Our beloved Auntie Betsy knew the provisions of Christ in her life. She knew that Jesus was the good shepherd. As we look towards David, who penned the Psalm 23, he was an old man and reflecting back on the tragedies and disappointments and the achievements of his life. And he knew God was with him as the good shepherd. And so, dear friends, we as children also have the ability and the assurance also to call Jesus the good shepherd. And what does Jesus do for us as the good shepherd? For those who are followers of Christ and disciples of Christ knows the following and confirm that through their witness. Provision. I have all that I need. Peace. I have rest from my weary journey. Protection, I have safety from my enemies. Providence, I have guidance in times of confusion and disillusionment. Presence, I have a companion when the way is lonely. And we come to the finality, paradise. I have a home awaiting for me in heaven. David knew that God was beneath him in green pastures, beside him in still waters, before him at the table, behind him pursuing him with goodness and mercy, beyond him preparing a heavenly home, and with him all the while as the good shepherd. David had given more, has been given more than what he deserved. And I suppose that is true for Auntie Betsy as well. Beloved, the above can be our experience, too, of a generous God and a loving and forgiving Son, Jesus Christ. Auntie Betsy experienced this in her life. And so we may ask, what is the qualification for you and me to experience this in our own life? So allow me to share two facts about God and then conclude that the final resting place our God provided for all who believe in him. And so we believe that Betsy is experiencing that place as she passed on from this life to the next life. First of all, friends, God's goodness comes from his nature and not our worthiness, as the psalm proclaims in verse 6. Surely denotes a fact as certain as it is comforting. Too good to be true, you may ask? No. God is much too good not to be true. He is good. As good as you and I are capable of imagining him to be. He's the only good person in the world. Hence, Betsy had the tenacity and the foresight to hold on to that good person. Secondly, God's love comes from his character and not our virtue. The Psalms are filled with affirmations of God's love towards us. But in Psalm 23, David writes, "Surely goodness and love will follow me all the days of my life." David's words for God's tender affection is a term used in the ancient world to mean love that flows out of a deep emotion rather than a sense of duty. It is a kind of gentle love, that attractive old world kind of love. And it's the best translation that we can find. And though we do not deserve that kind of love, God freely gives it. Friends, God's nature is to love sacrificiously, selflessly, extravagantly, and beyond the wildest expectations. Never was this more significantly true portrayed on the rugged cross as Jesus, sinless, died for us and granted us salvation. And we go to the third point. God's house draws us home. There's something magnetic about home. It always draws us back. If you have stayed over with a friend or family for the first time, you long for home. When you've been out on the road on what seems like a month of endless Sundays, you desire your own bed. And so for the believer, being in the earthly body is being away from the eternal resting place called home, heaven. And so now we know Betsy is no longer in the mortal body, but in eternity, enjoying the privilege of heaven at the second coming of Christ. David closes the 23rd Psalm with a mighty crescendo of faith when he declares, "I will dwell in the house of the Lord forever." The word "and" is one of the most important connections in the Bible. It connects yesterday and today and tomorrow. God says, "I've got this great life plan for you, and surely goodness and mercy will follow you through it." But that's not the end. I have something else at the end. The word "dwell," friends, means to reside or to settle down and to be at home. The word "house" means family or household or flock of the Good Shepherd. It denotes God's presence with us. The word "forever" means the length of one's days. For all one's time, David is saying to us that he never wants to step away from God. He craves to remain in the aura, in the atmosphere, and in the awareness that he is in God's house and with God. Auntie Betsy's desire was exactly that, to dwell with God and in the house of the Lord here on earth as she is now with him in heaven. In conclusion, if I may ask so boldly, or be so presumptuous to ask, if you could ask God for one thing, what would that be? What would your request be? David tells us that he would ask, he longs to dwell in the house of the Lord. David does not want to have a cup of coffee or an engagement. He wants to move in. He wants to stay forever. He does not seek temporary assignment, but rather lifelong residence. And so what will it be for us, dear friend? Often preachers lament at funerals that the hour is now and the time is urgent for us to make a decision whether we're going to dwell with the Father here on earth and pass from this life to the next life and continue to dwell with the Father. And some of us reluctantly think we have time. But COVID-19 has taught us the hour is now. There's no longer tomorrow. There's no maybe, no if or but. If you and I want to dwell and pass on from this life like Auntie Betsy did, in the serenity, the peace, the awe of moving towards the eternal light of God, what will that decision be, dear friend? I leave you with that thought. And I hope and pray that as we leave this assembly, that we may ponder and reflect on our life like David does in Psalm 23. And whether we can say, "The Lord is my shepherd." In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. Amen.
2017, I was diagnosed with a very serious life-threatening illness. And during the course of hospitalization and intensive treatment thereafter, if you want to call me that, whatever you want to call me, but through baptism we are all one in Christ, we are all Christians. But that I used to look forward to those little greetings from your Anglican friend. I'll be forever grateful to her and to her children, her sisters, brother, to all of you, my deepest sympathies and prayers. May she truly rest in peace. Let us pray. Let us pray for our sister Betsy, to our Lord Jesus Christ, who said, I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will live even though they die, and every living person who puts their faith in me will never suffer eternal death. Lord, you wept at Lazarus, at the death of Lazarus, your friend. Comfort us, and especially the Fenike and Kampfer families, in their sorrow. You raise the dead to life. Give your sister Betsy eternal life. You promised paradise to the thief who repented. Bring our sister to the joys of heaven. Our sister was washed clean in baptism and anointed with the oil of salvation. Give Betsy fellowship with all your saints. She was nourished with your body and blood. Grant her a place at the table in your heavenly kingdom. Comfort us in our sorrow at the death of our sister Betsy. Let our faith be our consolation and eternal life our hope. In a moment of silence, let us give thanks to God for our personal remembrance, memories, and joys witnessed to us through the life of Betsy. Lord, listen to our prayers for our sister Betsy. As she always desired to do your will, so in your mercy forgive whatever wrong she may have done through human weakness. By her Christian faith, she was united with all your believing people. Now, in love and mercy, give her a place with your angels and saints. For all of us gathered here and online. Loving Father, your days are without end, your mercies beyond counting. Help us to remember that life is short, and the day of our death is known to you alone. May your Holy Spirit lead us to live in holiness and justice all our days. Then, after serving you in the fellowship of your church, may we joyfully come to your kingdom. And we ask this through Christ our Lord. Eternal rest grant unto Betsy, O Lord, and let perpetual light shine upon her. May her soul and the souls of all the faithful departed, through the mercy of God, rest in peace, in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
We remain in a posture of prayer as we listen to the Our Father. Christ, we are using the reserved sacrament due to time constraints. Our beloved Auntie Betsy's last wish was to receive communion, but that was not possible due to her attracting COVID. So in honor of that request, we're going to share communion with the family. The bread which we break is not a sharing of the body of Christ. We do not presume to come to this your table, merciful Lord, trusting in our own righteousness, but in your manifold and great mercies. We are not worthy to gather up the crumbs under your table, but you are the same Lord, whose nature is always to have mercy. Such therefore, gracious Lord, so to eat the flesh of your dear Son, Jesus Christ, that we may evermore dwell in him and he in us. Beloved in Christ, draw near and receive the body of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he gave for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving.
Could we stand for the hymn, All Hail the Power of Jesus' Name?
Known to you for the soul of thy servant Betsy. Lord God, keep not her transgressions before her. We beseech thee, Lord, have mercy on thy servant Betsy. Purge me with hyssop and I shall be clean. Wash me and I shall be whiter than snow. Even though I walk through the valley of the shadow of death, I will fear no evil, for thou art with me, thy rod and thy staff protects me. Lord God, bring not thy servant into judgment, for none is righteous before you. We beseech thee, O Lord, have mercy on thy servant Betsy. Let us pray. Lord God, you have taken Auntie Betsy from this naughty and wicked world. We beseech thee now, Lord, that your angels may receive her into paradise, where death is no more, where crying and pain is no more, but only eternal life for those who believe and trust in you as Lord and God. Amen.
You remain standing as you receive the blessing. Beloved in Christ, the peace of God which passes all understanding, keep your hearts and minds in the knowledge and love of God and of His Son, Jesus Christ, our Lord, and the blessing of God Almighty, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you always. Amen.
Amen.
We shall now have the recessional hymn, and then we will indicate when the pallbearers just need to come. The congregation remains standing. We proceed to the Parkland Kale Cemetery for the